Can I welcome everyone to the second meeting of the Education and Schools Committee in 2017. Can I please remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of the meeting. The first item of business is a decision on whether to take a number of items of business in private. Firstly, is everyone content that item four of this meeting is in private? Thank you. Next week, we have witnesses on widening access to higher education. Are members content that the item to review the evidence on widening access is also taken in private? Thank you. The second item of business is a negative instrument on assessment request for Gaelic medium education. Do members have any comments on this instrument, Liz?
Vina, would it be possible for the committee to have an update on the numbers of pupils who are involved in Gaelic medium education and also the number of staff, because we had an issue, as you know, at the last committee about that. So it'd be just as a point of information, yeah, it'd be helpful to have that.
We'll ask for that information to be sent. Thank you. And the third item today is a session on curriculum for excellence. The focus today is on the responsibility and accountability for decision making in relation to CFE. The committee agreed to hold this session as a result of evidence from Education Scotland, the SQA and education authorities on the functioning of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board and the implementation of its decisions. It's useful to have the government's chair of the board, the SQA, Education Scotland and the education authorities representatives all around the table at the same time to discuss issues that we explored with organisations separately in evidence sessions last year. It's also valuable to have other board members here to convey their own independent perspective on how decision making on CFE operates in practice. A welcome to the meeting, Fiona Robertson, the Director of Learning, Scottish Government, Dr Janet Brown, Chief Executive, Scottish Qualifications Authority, Dr Bill Maxwell, Chief Executive, Education Scotland, Terry Lanigan, Executive Officer, Association of Directors of Education in Scotland, Larry Flanagan, General Secretary of the Education Institute of Scotland, Seamus Searson, General Secretary, Scottish Secondary Teachers Association, and Joanna Murphy, National Parent Forum of Scotland. As everyone can see, we have a large panel and I have asked members to direct their questions at individuals. We will not make much progress if everyone in the panel answers every question. If you would like to come in on a question that's not directed at you, please catch my eye and, circumstances permitting, I will call you in. Lastly, if there's a point you feel ought to be made but didn't get the opportunity to make it, you're very welcome to write to the committee after this session as the committee plans to undertake work on the Curriculum for Excellence on an ongoing basis. I'd like to open the session by asking Fiona Robertson, as Chair of the Board, for her perspective on the decision-making processes, including the Board's role for Curriculum for Excellence.
Thanks very much. I'm very happy to do so. Good morning, everyone. The Scottish Government and Education Scotland provided a written submission in advance of this morning's session, and that paper outlines briefly the governance structures which have supported the development of Curriculum for Excellence. As well as the Management Board, this includes the Curriculum for Excellence Implementation Group and the Assessment and National Qualifications Group, both agreed by the Management Board and established in 2011 and 2016, respectively. Over the years, the Management Board has been supported in its work by a number of groups agreed by the Board and indeed by ministers to provide advice on specific issues. As the committee is aware, the development of Curriculum for Excellence has been a really very significant reform in Scottish education to enrich and deepen the learning experience of children and young people, and has involved all parts of the education system. The Scottish Government has, of course, led the development of policy and the broad national framework, working with education bodies, local authorities, professional associations, parents, teachers and other partners to make key decisions. And the membership of the Management Board itself is drawn from right across the education system. As the OECD review highlighted, it occupied and has occupied a central position in the development of Curriculum for Excellence itself. The development of Curriculum for Excellence has been driven by consensus and collective responsibility, recognising that all parts of the system needed to work together to deliver, from national policy right through to learning and teaching in the classroom. And the Management Board has been an important mechanism for achieving that consensus. It's fair to say that issues are raised, strong views will come forward, and conversations can be challenging, but the approach has been to work closely with the whole system to develop the broad framework and to consider issues around implementation. Notwithstanding the value of that consensual approach, the Board is clear that ultimate responsibility for decision-making on national education policy rests with Scottish ministers. The Board may provide advice on policy, and Ministers may commission views on specific issues from the Board. And as Curriculum for Excellence is developed, I think the focus of the Board has shifted from design principles through the development of building the curriculum documents in 2008 to 2010, to the broad design of new qualifications, including through the qualifications governance group, and of course onto issues of timing and implementation through the work of the implementation group, which my colleague Bill Maxwell chairs. The Board has also considered risks to implementation and broader interdependencies, in particular the development of the National Improvement Framework more recently. And on the recommendation of the Management Board, Ministers have agreed to provide additional support to the system at key points in the implementation phase. It might be worth it stressing a couple of points before I conclude. First, the national education bodies, of course, have their own individual responsibilities in relation to curriculum for excellence and education delivery beyond the management of beyond the membership of the Management Board. And I know that you've heard evidence from both chief executives over recent months. Second, it is important to note that while the broad framework of curriculum for excellence is set nationally, decisions about how best to implement it rest with schools, teachers and local authorities. This is one of the essential characteristics of curriculum for excellence. It places the learner at the heart of learning and gives teachers the flexibility to make decisions locally about what their learners need. The statutory responsibility for the delivery of education, of course, rests with local government. And just to say just one final thing about the Management Board itself and the future of the Management Board. The OECD highlighted that governance of curriculum for excellence had been well fitted to the task as a Scotland-wide curriculum programme, and that task required consensus and managing processes so that implementation, including of assessment and qualifications, would happen as smoothly as possible. There is value in moving from this national system management approach to a more strategic role with greater emphasis on the nature of teaching, learning and curriculum development in schools. However, the review also highlighted the inherent complexity of governance in every education system. I know a number of Management Board members would agree with the view of the OECD that I've just expressed, and indeed the EIS submission to the committee does so. The Deputy First Minister has confirmed separately to this committee in December that he will consider the ongoing governance of Curriculum for Excellence as part of the Education Governance Review. I'd be happy to answer any further questions from the committee.
Thank you very much. Before I throw it out to the other members of the committee, can I ask you, what do you see as the Scottish Government's role in ensuring the changes that we've asked for in our recent report from the agencies be carried out through the Management Board in other ways?
Well, the Management Board will have a role in looking at the conclusions of the report that you published earlier this week, but the individual agencies, both the SQA and Education Scotland in particular, in the context of Curriculum for Excellence, will also wish to consider those conclusions as part of their own governance arrangements.
Okay, thank you very much. Tavish?
I could ask Ms. Robertson a number of questions about what the Board actually does. Has this Board been responsible since 2011 for the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence?
In 2011, the CFE Implementation Group was established, and that's chaired by the Chief Executive of Education Scotland, Bill Maxwell. And that has comprised the national bodies with responsibility for implementing Curriculum for Excellence, notably Education Scotland. SQA is also involved, ADES, and more recently, Skills Development Scotland, given the importance of the developing young workforce agenda in the senior phase. So the implementation plans, the detailed reporting of Curriculum for Excellence has been taken forward by the implementation group, together with consideration of other issues relating to risk and indeed communications. So all the national bodies have been represented on that board.
Who's on it? I was asking about what it does.
The implementation group, yeah. Yes.
And what's the implementation group's relationship to this management board that you chair?
The implementation group reports to at every meeting of the management board. It provides the chief executive. The management board meets on a quarterly basis, and it tends to follow the meetings of the implementation group, so that there's a timely report through the implementation group to the management board.
Minutes. So, I can't find a specific item on the minutes which says item number one, the implementation curriculum for excellence. What's happening?
You will find in the minutes at every meeting, certainly since 2011, that there is a report from Bill Maxwell as the chair of the implementation group on implementation issues and indeed on issues relating to communications. I can confirm that those
are
in
the minutes. Minutes of the June the 13th, 2012, where ADES, Christine Pollock, particularly cites the need to consider the potential workload issues for teachers in reviewing nationally produced course materials. What happened after that, given this issue has come up time and time and time again ever since? What did the Management Board do about that?
About the workload, about mm-hmm. workload issues in particular? Yep. Well, the Management Board have discussed workload issues on a number of occasions.
What did you do? What are your actions?
Well, I've been the chair of the Management Board since September 2013, so I'm afraid I can't comment on that particular meeting because I wasn't at that particular meeting.
So workforce planning, workload was never raised again since in all the time you've been chairing
No, absolutely, workload has been raised. There have been a number of mechanisms to look at that. The work of the implementation group in terms of the CFE implementation plan and the support that the Education Scotland and the SQA and others, including local authorities, can provide to the system. In 2014 and in 2015, the Management Board agreed to set up a reflections group on the new qualifications, which considered workload issues, and there was a reporting mechanism through that.
In my life, when I run meetings, I want to see actions that follow from the initial discussion about a particular issue,
absolutely,
which we know is concerning. And I have done my best to read all your minutes, and I struggle to find the timeline or the actions which flow on workforce workload that teachers are raising with all of us for, you know, all these years of Curriculum for Excellence. And then we get to evidence that we got the other day where 20,000 pages of guidance was provided to teachers in evidence from Education Scotland. And I can't find in all your minutes what you did about that. I don't mean you personally, I mean your board, what your board did about that.
The minutes are agreed by board members. They include a number of actions. What I was saying to you at the start was that the detailed programme planning relating to Curriculum for Excellence is undertaken by the Curriculum for Excellence Implementation Group. That plan...
Bill Maxwell wants to come in on this.
That plan is agreed by the Management Board and indeed is circulated widely to the system. And that includes measures to address workload, amongst other things. And that has been the focus of the implementation programme since 2011.
Yeah, thanks, convener. And I was around in 2012, so I can maybe elucidate a bit, as were many other members of the panel here. The issue around at that point was very much around the requirement that was clearly there for schools to develop new courses to suit the new qualifications, clearly. And the issue, by my recollection at that time, was not about... it was more about the lack of or a desire for more guidance for schools at that point, which resulted indeed in a direct request as part of deep discussions that went on through the Management Board and Implementation Group around how to support schools and teachers in that process of developing courses, with the emphasis being very much on not providing a single national syllabus, because Curriculum for Excellence is all about moving away, in a sense, from providing a one-size-fits-all national syllabus, but rather to encouraging schools to develop courses that were suitable for their pupils in their local circumstances. CFE gives them that freedom. And at that point, the outcome of all that discussion was an agreement that we should actually produce course materials, but do so by brokering the exchange often. We worked closely with ADIS on this for each of the 95 N5 courses at that time. Education Scotland took the lead, working with other agencies and other parties around the table here in coordinating a process which is effectively supporting teachers, helping their workload by giving them some ideas, guidance, exchanging content of course material that they might want to use in developing their own courses over the course of the next period. And that was done for National 5 initially, or the Nationals 5 and 4. It then moved on to Higher and Advanced Higher as the years went on, as part of a planned and agreed process to help workload.
But it can't have been an agreed process to end up...
One more question to Bill, right?
Yeah. But it can't have been an agreed process to end up with 20,000 pages of guidance.
That's would what came out of that was a range of exemplification of course materials, welcomed very much by parties at the time and served a very useful purpose as schools were adapting to develop new courses. It's only a small part of the overall package of digital resources.
20,000 pages is a pretty big part, personally, but can I ask Fiona Robertson, did the Management Board ever consider, in all these minutes which I can find, the fact that 20,000 pages of guidance were issued to teachers?
The issue of 20,000 pages is not something that's been explicitly raised at the Management Board, but I think that the point that Bill has raised is important, because the Management Board was responsive to the needs of the system at the time. And so, for example, in March 2012, where there was a support package provided, including course materials, and again in February 2014, they were warmly welcomed by all the professional associations, and indeed had been requested by them. So I have statements here from the EIS, from the General Secretary of School Leaders Scotland, from the Chair of the National Parent Forum at the time, all welcoming these measures, and indeed it's stating very clearly that these would address workload issues. I think it's important to highlight that the delivery plan that was published by the Scottish Government last June makes it clear that one of the Scottish Government's priorities is to do some of that decluttering. The time is now right to look at that material and to see whether it's still helpful. So the work that Education Scotland have done around the materials that they've produced and have been reviewing, I think is very welcome. But I think it's really important to highlight that the board was responsive to the needs of the system at the time, and indeed that material was welcomed.
Come on.
If the board was responsive to the concerns, why is it that we had 20,000, whatever number of pages it is, that suddenly disappeared? Who took that decision? Was it the Management Board, or was that a decision by the Cabinet Secretary?
To
declutter and remove so many bits of advice to teachers?
Well, decisions relating, as I highlighted in my opening statement, decisions around the broad policy framework for curriculum for excellence rest with the Scottish Government and with Scottish ministers. But again, Mr. Swinney will have and indeed had conversations with Bill Maxwell as Chief Executive of Education Scotland and as Chief Education Advisor, and with others in reaching the conclusion around the decluttering of the curriculum,
if I may, and
indeed from teachers themselves.
I think the main concern that we have as a committee, and which is very clearly explicit in our report, is that for some very considerable period of time, there has been a great deal of advice issued to teachers, and a vast majority of that guidance now appears to be redundant. Our concern is that over that length of time, that it seems as though decisions were taken about the value of this advice, when in fact it wasn't actually the advice that was going to be useful. And a long period of time has gone past, and therefore parents and pupils and staff have a right to ask who made the decision about issuing that guidance in the first place, only to find that several years down the road, it was actually redundant.
Well, the decision at the time to produce the guidance was through a process of discussion and agreement at the Management Board, which was subsequently agreed by ministers and indeed welcomed by members of the Management Board and the professional associations at the time. I think the OECD review is instructive here, though, because the review highlighted that Scotland had been bold in its curriculum reforms, but also needed to be specific. And I think some of the messages in the OECD review itself suggested that some of that paring back of materials would be helpful. So, as I say, I think the Management Board has been, again, responsive to the needs of the system. I think that a lot of the workload concerns that have been raised relate to the unintended and unsustainable level of assessment in the system, and SQA have taken action and are taking action around that, and that's been agreed through the Assessment and National Qualifications Group. So I think the Management Board's responsibility has a collective responsibility, given its broad membership, established since 2009, has been to to seek the views of those that are around the table. All the teacher professional associations are around that table, and to respond accordingly and to advise ministers.
Flanagan.
Thanks, Convener. Just a couple of points. I mean, clearly, in relation to workload, that's an issue which the teacher unions have been particularly exercised about, and those concerns were reiterated at numerous CFE management board meetings. I would want to make the point, however, that if you look at the SPICE briefing, almost all of the attempts at alleviating workload pressures actually came about as a consequence of almost always of direct interaction with Scottish Government. So when Mike Russell announced an additional £1 million funding around the new qualifications, that was after EIS had engaged with them around the need to provide support. Now, that channelled its way back into the management board, which was a conduit for making the actual formal decisions. But a lot of these were bilateral. The Tackling Bureaucracy Working Group, which was technically a subgroup of the management board, came about when Mike Russell announced at the EIS conference that he would respond to our concerns on workload by setting up this group. The reflections groups were set up in response to calls from the unions for a review of the process of implementation. So a number of these things, I think, as was the National Qualification Review Group, which came from the second reflections report. So a number of these things were part of the management board discussions, but were also part of a more direct political process around the unions making direct representation. In terms of the board itself, I think it is useful to differentiate between the development phase of CFE, when the board was a model of good practice in terms of collaborative approaches, and did give very strong advice to ministers around the direction of travel, which was almost always accepted, and when we moved into implementation, particularly around the qualifications, because that's when a lot of the operational pressures manifested themselves. And what happened in practice is that the board had an overview of the implementation process, and you know, Fiona alluded to the fact here that there was nearly always an implementation group update to the board. But the board itself did not micromanage any of the agencies. So SQA were always very clear that it had its own governance structure, it has its own publicly appointed board, and it was responsible to SQA. Education Scotland doesn't have any governance arrangement beyond, I think, its own advisory group and minister. We would quite often take our concerns with SQA or with Education Scotland directly to bilateral discussions with them, because they weren't necessarily the province of the board. The board had a much broader overview of progress. And in relation to that, I think there are two relevant points just to finish on. One is that throughout my period on the board, and I think for most of the early part of implementation, in terms of the implementation programme of CFE, communications was always a difficult area. During my period, it was almost always amber in terms of, you know, red, green, amber system. It was never green, and a couple of times it dipped into red. And there has always been a real challenge around communicating headline decisions to the schools. In relation to the point around these 20,000 pages, actually, I think if you ask most teachers, they would say, I didn't know they were there. You know, so we often made the point that putting something on a website is not the same as effective communication. And that was a real challenge around a lot of the communication strategy. And we had this discussion with the SQA as well around the changes, because the biggest gap that's developed is the gap between decisions at a national level and things being published, i.e. available on a website, and schools and teachers finding the time to actually engage with that information and put it into effective practice. And all of the problems we've got around, or most of the problems we've got around the qualifications, came about because of the lack of time for schools to engage with those headline decisions. And that's been the source of a great deal of the difficulties that the board and schools have faced over the last few years.
Thanks very much for that. A couple of things come for that. One is that the communications issue was one that came up time and time again through the education, and it was mentioned quite strongly in the report. But the other is that it may well be that there's bilateral discussions, but the management board has got this overview, and if there's page after page after page after page of new guidance coming in, surely somebody in the management board, I would suggest particularly the EIS and the Association of Directors of Education of Scotland, would be thinking, hold on a second here, this is going to impact hugely on our workforce, you know, our members or our workforce in the case of the directors. What is happening? Why are we adding on and not looking at which is now redundant? And that's the point I'm struggling with the management board. If they've got this overview, look, surely they've got an overview about not just the purpose of the new stuff that's coming in, but is there now stuff that is no longer needed? Because as long as it's there, it adds to the load of the workforce.
What the management board would get would be an indication from Education Scotland or SQA that they intend to publish advice on a particular area. They wouldn't bring that advice to the meeting. So they might indicate in response to a request around clarification on some course elements of the units, they're going to publish advice. Now, in our bilateral discussions, we'd quite often be saying that message isn't getting out there because people are not engaging with it. But, you know, and the board itself wouldn't be looking at the detail of that advice. They would accept a general indication that the appropriate agency was seeking to respond to it. Now, that has been part of the difficulty because if you even take Education Scotland's clear and unambiguous statement from earlier in this session, as soon as I saw it, I said to Bill, that's neither clear nor unambiguous. Right? I said, I don't think that is going to fulfil what you think it's going to do. And we had a fairly robust discussion around that. So there has been a lot of feedback around it. Bill mentioned there the creation of the units. What we got from the Scottish Government, it was Mike Russell at the time, was a commitment that they would be ready to use unit assessments in relation to National 5. And that was National 4, National 5. And that was to relieve the workload pressure. And that was defaulted to Education Scotland to coordinate. They commissioned some independent creation of the unit assessments. By and large, they worked through the local authorities, most of whom volunteered to make a contribution, many of which subsequently then didn't make that contribution. We were quite sceptical about the quality of a number of those unit assessments, and part of the workload pressure came because in schools, people just decided to make their own units and go on with it. So, you know, there was an attempt to create the units, right, but it didn't fulfil the gap, and schools started getting on with creating their own units. And that's where, and that was all to do with the fact that people were talking about units in a different way. Schools were still talking about units as they used to exist under INT1, INT2, and the units in terms of the new qualifications were meant to be a different type of beast. So there was a bit of a miscommunication around what people were actually looking for.
Very briefly then, it suggests to me that information comes in a sort of almost esoteric form to the management board. There seems to be no recognition of the impact that's going to have on the ground. Should there be more discussion round about, okay, this may well affect your members, this may well affect your employers, this may well affect other aspects of one of the agencies or the other members of the management board, can you make sure you communicate this appropriately? Because there's no point in somebody coming in and saying, we're going to bring forward guidance, and then at some stage, because somebody brings it to your attention, for example, you think, we better get moving on this. And just a very brief answer for that.
Well, the key example in relation to that was around the timeline for the introduction of the qualifications, because we pushed very strongly for a further year's delay to allow schools time to assimilate the changes, because they were significant. That was the only time we actually had a vote in all the time I was on the management board, and that was defeated. And we pushed ahead with the timetable. And schools simply did not have the time to assimilate the changes that were required around BGE and senior phase. SQA had a very tight timetable in terms of their production of materials. They met that timetable, but schools couldn't make the changes. So what happened was most schools defaulted to what is the minimal change we need to make. And the minimal change was we'll replace standard grade with NAT 4, NAT 5. We'll stick with a 2+2 timetable structure, which means that the S3 profile doesn't exist. Therefore, you don't use an S3 profile to create your senior phase. And we ended up in a situation where people were trying to squeeze 8 courses into 1 year, and you can't do 8 times 160 in a school's year. It doesn't work. So we ended up with a hybrid situation based on the fact that schools had to get through the year and make sure young people didn't suffer, and the fact that there was insufficient time. And almost all the problems we have around units might have been avoided if we'd had a different timeline around that introduction. But that timeline created the real pressures on schools, created some of the decisions which were not consistent with what the aims of CFE were, and led us into a situation where we're now having to revisit the qualifications to make them fit the pattern that's been developed across Scotland.
Okay, thank you. I'm not convinced that I really got the answer about the why we didn't pick up on the workload earlier about the staffing, but Fiona, you wanted to come in.
It was really just about the particular issue around the year's delay that the EIS requested. I mean, I think it might be worth just in terms of relaying the facts around that particular area. In October 2008, the Management Board agreed to a recommendation to recommend to ministers for an additional implementation year, and that recommendation was accepted at the time. Subsequent discussions in April 2010 around the timing of the introduction of the new qualifications, three options were discussed in that at that meeting. One was to continue with the current plan, which was new qualifications from 2013-14. The second was to dual run standard grade and the new qualifications for one or more years. And the third was to delay a year. And the board agreed that they should be phased in over the three-year period as agreed from 2013-14, option one. I think it's important to note that only the EIS were in disagreement, requesting a delay for a further year. I mean, Larry's right in a sense about the vote, but I think it's important that at the most recent meeting of the Management Board, the board again were asked for their views on the removal of unit assessments from the national qualifications, and all agreed. I don't know whether that would constitute a vote as such, but all members were asked to provide a formal view on the removal of unit assessments. So there were and continue to be robust discussions as part of the Management Board. The implementation group was set up as a vehicle in that key implementation phase to do that detailed planning and assessment. The Management Board and indeed ministers are asked to sign off the CFE implementation plan on an annual basis. That includes elements around communications, which are updated at every Management Board meeting. So I think it's important that kind of that as the CFE moved towards implementation, the implementation group was set up, and therefore the Management Board was in a new phase of its business.
But how does that answer the question that I was asking Larry Flanagan about how we continue to add to the workload, and nobody recognised that if you kept on adding and didn't take away that it was going to impact on the staffing? Yes, Mr. Larry.
I don't think it would be true to say that we continue to add to the workload. The 20,000 pages, the way that it's been talked about here, it makes it sound as if every teacher would have to plough through 20,000 pages. That's just not the case. A lot, and as was said earlier, much of the advice that came out and the guidance that came out was in direct response to requests from the profession for additional guidance. The other thing that I would say is that you might get the impression from what we've heard so far that the Management Board and the Implementation Group exist in some higher plane with no connection at all to the real world of what's going on in the classroom. Now, if I can maybe illustrate the role that ADES has played in bridging that gap, I was a member of the Management Board and the Implementation Group. but when I was a serving director, I also chaired the ADES Curriculum Assessment and Qualifications Network, which met on a quarterly basis and which typically would have in excess of 20 local authorities represented at it. Now, at every meeting that, of that group, which I chaired for 5 years, SQA, Education Scotland, and the Scottish Government were represented for the whole morning. And at that meeting, at those meetings, what we did was we discussed directly the implementation, the live implementation issues. And the local authorities then went back and dealt with those issues with their schools and with their teachers. There was also a significant amount of work going on at local authority level through LNCTs to look directly at the workload issues and to try to address locally where it was perceived that that these issues existed. And part of that work, and I can speak about that because I was involved in it directly, was to try to cut through to get to the core of what it was that teachers needed to do. So I think we need to be careful about assuming that, it may well be that because in response to requests, the amount of advice became unwieldy, and that's what's being addressed just now and being acknowledged just now. But that doesn't, the addition of additional advice doesn't mean that the workload was being increased by that.
Okay, there's a number of committee members wanting to come in just now, but if you continue to, I go back to the same point, if you continue to add on and you don't look at what you can take away, then clearly the possibility of an increased workload is there. Otherwise, the Cabinet Secretary wouldn't have been taking the role, the task that he's taken on just now. He wouldn't be saying, we need to get rid of this, a lot of this review, because it's out of date, because it's not required. So I don't really think that both things stands up. If the Cabinet Secretary says that this is required, it means that it was required as the 20,000 were being built up on. So, Daniel.
My line of questioning, I think, actually directly relates to what Larry Flanagan has just said. And can I just thank Larry Flanagan? I think that was a very revealing couple of responses that he gave. I mean, I'm primarily concerned about the design of Curricula for Excellence and how that sits with the qualification system. Indeed, when Janet Brown was before us, before at the close of her evidence, she said that the issues we were looking at in teachers were a result of the design and implementation and the way that the qualification system worked. I think some of the points that we looked at in committee were around narrowing, and particularly around science subjects. I think Joanne Lamont and both Tavish Scott asked questions around that. Tavish Scott also asked about the deliverability of 160 hours. Yeah, okay. On those points, can I just ask Fiona Robertson, were those points of design, do you accept that those points of design are the responsibility of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board?
The design principles, I've obviously looked back at this, the design principles were absolutely discussed at the management board. And indeed, there were a number of building the curriculum documents in the early years of the management board, including a discussion on assessment principles. So the broad principles absolutely were discussed and agreed by management board, subsequently agreed by ministers. And thereafter, the SQA designed and developed the qualifications. There was a subgroup to the management board called the Qualifications Governance Group, which did some of that detailed work. And I'm sure Janet would be happy to elaborate on the work of that group. So the broad principles absolutely were agreed. And indeed, with the formation of the Assessment and National Qualifications Group, some of that work is being revisited, given the remit of that group.
That's not an adequate response, and I'll tell you why. Because in response to Anna Lamont's questioning around whether or not three sciences could be taken forward by students, and in response to Tavish Scott's questioning around whether or not the 160 hours meant that there would be a narrowing, both Bill Maxwell and Janet Brown said that those decisions were the responsibility of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board. Your answer does not give that clarity. Indeed, you seem to be pointing both upwards and down the stream to other bodies which are responsible. Who is responsible for these points?
You've highlighted three issues: the broad design principles of the national qualifications, issues around curriculum models which are in schools and which define what young people can choose to take at different times in their schooling, and also issues around the number of subjects that young people can take. The Management Board set out in 2011 issues relating to the articulation between the broad general education and the senior phase. There was a subsequent restatement of those issues around the articulation by Bill Maxwell as Chief Inspector in May of this year. I think that the Management Board has been very clear that given the design of Curriculum for Excellence and the responsibility of the Management Board in setting the broad national framework, that decisions around curriculum models are largely for local authorities and for schools, and I'm sure Terry would be happy to elaborate on that.
Basic design point about whether or not breadth can be carried forward, and is that breadth, in terms of broad, as a broad general design point, is that your responsibility or not?
The breadth of, well,
the number of subjects that it is possible to take through National 4 and 5 and again at higher.
Is that
your responsibility or not?
Well, I can only restate what I've just said, which was that the Management Board provided guidance on this in 2011, and there was a restatement of that guidance by the Chief Inspector in 2016. The numbers of subjects that are available to individual students in schools is a matter for local authorities and for schools, and that has been the design. That has been the design of Curriculum for Excellence over the years, and I think that's
important. So, given the length of the school day and the length of the school year, there is a practical issue about how much you can deliver. Now, can I just ask what impact assessment was made based on the design of the qualifications, whether or not that design would lead to a narrowing of the number of subjects? Was that an assessment that the Management Board made, and was a subsequent management assessment made after implementation?
There was work done by Education Scotland in 2012 to look at emerging curriculum models in schools in the run-up to the national qualifications. The Curriculum Assessment and Qualifications Group, which Terry referred to, will also review issues around curriculum design as well. In relation, I think, to the three sciences that was raised at committee in November, I think Dr. Maxwell highlighted that actually the number of students undertaking three sciences in one sitting has remained largely static over time. So that's not been a particular issue of difference. But there's a broader point here, which I think is that the senior phase is a three-year senior phase. And as has been stated both in the 2011 Management Board statement and in Bill's statement from this year, it's really important that we don't look at 1 year in isolation. So I think there's some broader points that we need to consider. But I think Terry might want to highlight some of the issues around the individual responsibilities of local authorities and indeed schools around the curriculum models and the numbers of subjects that can be taken. But Bill Maxwell has provided advice on that, and that has...
Okay, all right, we're done with that one. Thank you very much. Before Terry comes in, can I ask Gillian to come in?
Yeah, I want to pick up on something that's actually come out of what Mr Flanagan was talking about there that piqued my interest with regard to local authorities. You said that some local authorities didn't make a contribution to the process of review of the implementation. And probably my only reservation about the evidence that we gathered being people could anonymously submit was that we have no idea of the geographical spread of some of the issues and complaints that came up. So really my questions for Mr. Lanagan, representing the local authorities today, local authorities, is it variable across Scotland? And that given that local authorities have got such a responsibility in the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence, are there areas in Scotland where there's just not been that engagement from local authorities? And could you give me some more information, maybe answering some of Mr. Flanagan's points there?
Could I just make clear my role? I represent ADES, which is a member-led organisation of centrally deployed education staff. I don't speak for COSLA and I don't speak for local authorities. But what I would say is that there has been a very widespread engagement with the process of implementation of Curriculum for Excellence at local authority level. And as is indicated by what I said earlier, that typically at the network that I chaired, we would get in excess of 20 and sometimes as many as 25 local authorities represented. And that included authorities, the island authorities on many occasions. So there was, I would say, an engagement. The example that Larry gave earlier was authorities were asked to contribute examples of good practice, and there was a variable response across the country, but it was a very widespread response. And could I perhaps also go back to the earlier point about number of subjects and perhaps give you an example from my own experience. When I was director in Western Bartonshire, one of my secondary schools decided that they wanted to retain 8 subjects in S5, and the others went for 6 subjects in S5. Now, that would look as if there was a greater restriction. Oh, sorry, S4. In S4, sorry, I apologise. That would imply that the ones that went for the 6 subjects in S4 were being more restrictive. However, there are 2 aspects to that. First of all, in all of the schools where there were 6 subjects in S4, you could still take 3 sciences. And secondly, the disadvantage of the 8 model was that what you had in that school was you had 8 subjects in S4 and then 5 subjects in S5 and potentially 5 subjects in S6. Now, that meant a total over the 3 years potentially of 18. The ones that went for 6 in S4 also had 6 in S5 and 6 in S6, a total of 18 over the senior phase. In addition to that, the schools that chose to have the 6-6-6 model had the advantage that they could timetable S4 to S6 together. And that meant that there was a wider choice of subjects. More subjects became viable because you had larger numbers of youngsters who could contribute. The schools that did that also reported that there was a significant positive impact on the S4 cohort because many of them were in classes with S5 and S6, and the additional maturity that that brought had a positive impact on attitude, on behaviour, etc. So the debate about the S4, Fiona's right, you can't look at S4 in isolation. You've got to look at the whole of the senior phase, and you can continue to have the breadth of choice and also the specialism of three sciences, even if you go for 6 subjects in S4.
I'm going to bring in Mr. Flanagan in a minute, but can I just remind people this isn't just aimed at yourself, Mr. Flanagan, but one of the things that came across loud and clear when, and I'm sure Joanna Murphy will recognise this, during the evidence session was that very often, and it happens with everybody, we speak in the jargon that the profession uses. But remember, it's not just teachers and educationalists that are listening to this today. So if you can speak in a way that everybody understands, that would be much easier. Thank you very much. And can we keep it brief, please?
Yep. It was just in relation to Daniel Johnson's point around the senior phase and the aims of CFE. I mean, the 3 key aims around the senior phase were maintaining breadth across the senior experience, creating more teaching time for a greater depth of learning, because one of the criticisms had been people were passing exams but didn't have the depth of learning, and creating some parity of esteem between vocational and allegedly academic pathways. Now, if you were using those 3 criterion, where we are at the moment does not tick any of those boxes, in my view. And if we want to get there, we have to recognise where we are and realign to achieve those objectives. And part of the reason that we're not there is to do with a lack of communication around the changes that were required. And it's a dilemma, because at the heart of CFE is the idea, and this is at the heart of the governance review, that you let decisions be taken as close to possible at school level. But we're not very good in Scotland at actually letting people make decisions at a school level or a local authority level. But with CFE, there was a resistance from a number of agencies about being too directive. We actually argued on a number of occasions for Education Scotland to be more directive in terms of actually giving fairly clear advice. The one time they did it, in relation to East Wren, they got jumped on by a number of people who said, you know, you're trying to tell a local authority how to do its business. That was around retaining intermediates. So that's been part of the difficulty, because I think we could have done with a lot clearer advice around the interface between BGE and the senior phase. And one of the things we didn't do was sufficiently promote the bypass model, because the whole senior phase is predicated on the notion that nowadays most people stay on to S5, if not S6. Standard grade was designed for a period when kids left, by and large, at the end of S4. And we were looking at moving the whole qualification experience up 2 years to create that additional space. And we didn't manage to do that because we didn't have enough time to persuade schools that that was the direction to go in. And that's where a lot of the fracture lines have come from. Now, in the qualification review group where this has been discussed, I think there's general agreement that we still want to achieve the ambition, the original ambitions of the senior phase. And the changes that have been looked at now with the DFM leading the working group is how we actually realign the system. Because I don't think anyone suggests that the experience of the last 2 or 3 years was the ambition of the senior phase. Right? But that's where we are. And if we want to achieve the ambition, we need to look at what changes need to be made moving forward. And most of those are around the interface between the BGE, making sure that young people actually get a 3-year broad general education, they have an S3 profile, which is a starting point for their senior phase experience. And we look at actually more young people not sitting exams in S4, but actually getting more time to study for exams in S5. The real challenge there is, as a nation, we are thorough to assessment, right? Parents in my school, which does bypass, my school, I don't work there anymore, my old school, we do bypass. Nobody sits exams in S4. And every year, parents come and say, how come we're the only school that's doing this? Right? Because people don't like to be out of sync with others. We're only, well, no, but I know they're not the only school, but that's the question they ask, because they think they're the only school, because they're the only Glasgow school. So there are big challenges there.
Thank you very much, Mr. Flanagan. Mr. Maxwell.
You're right to highlight that is a dilemma that has been discussed frequently during the management board about to what extent to hold true to the principle that local design of the curriculum, local ownership has to exist locally in schools and local authorities, and therefore the guidance that I put out again in May last year does reflect guidance that was put out at the beginning of the process. It does promote ideas like bypassing as absolutely appropriate, but we're not prescribing to every school, you must have this exact curriculum model. That would be inappropriate in my view. So that is a dilemma undoubtedly Management Board has wrestled with throughout the process, but I think held true to the principle that fundamentally what we need is schools designing curricula that meet the needs of their students locally and take full advantage of the freedoms of Curriculum for Excellence, but we're not in the process in a position where we're prescribing to every school you must do X number of subjects in any particular year.
Joy.
Yeah, really just a couple of points that have come up so far. On this question about it being, we should look at it as 3 years, fair enough. I wonder if Fiona Robertson wants to comment the fact the universities don't look at it as 3 years. In order to get into some courses in university, now you have 5 hires in one sitting. Now, I taught in a school which made an active decision not to run 5 hires. Whether that was the right thing for that school or not, we can have a debate about. The consequence would be those youngsters are not even able to compete. So has there been a conversation with the universities to get them to understand the direct consequence in terms of equality of access to higher education of decisions being made and the number of subjects you can sit in school?
There absolutely were conversations and have been ongoing conversations with universities about these issues. Terry chaired the Learner Journey subgroup of the Management Board. And
can I ask what the conclusion of that conversation is? Yeah. You specifically said that it is reasonable that we look at this over 3 years. A young person has to have 5 hours in one sitting. Now, I'll deal with the question about equity amongst fourth year at a later stage. I'm not just obsessing about youngsters who have got in the fortunate position of even competing for a university place. But no, if someone cannot sit 5 hours in one sitting, there will be some course of university they simply cannot access. What has been, now I'm asking Fiona Robertson, what has been the conclusion of your conversations with universities about that matter? Because you asserted we should look at it over 3 years. The universities are not doing that.
There were discussions with the universities, in particular, to the, in the lead up to the qualifications being reformed, and the conversation was particularly around S4 and the number of subjects in S4.
You said in response to a question, the fact of the matter is we should look at this as a 3 year project for young people. Yeah. Universities do not look, we are rationing our university places on the basis of qualification. You need 5 hires for certain subjects in one sitting. You're telling me that it's perfectly reasonable for loads of young people not to have the opportunity to sit 5 hires in one sitting.
Yeah. Mr. Lanigan, you seem to want to come
in. I think there's a fundamental misunderstanding here with respect. I chaired a subgroup of the management board, which was about the learner journey, which engaged with universities. And as a result of the work that group did, every higher education institution in Scotland came out with a statement saying that they would be supporting the new qualifications and would not discriminate against any youngster as a result of the the curriculum model that their school had adopted. I don't know of a school in Scotland, Ms. Lamont, where you can't do 5 hires in fifth year. It is, and what Fiona was talking about was about the youngster at the start of S4 planning their journey over 3 years. Now, for youngsters that are wanting to do medicine or veterinary medicine or dentistry and one or two other subjects, part of that three-year plan will be to do 5 hires in S5. And I literally know of no school in Scotland where that is not possible.
So you can't, every young person can access 5 hires in fifth year. That's obviously, we've obviously been entirely misled in that question. On this issue around guidance, if I reflect on my own practice as a school teacher, if I give out directions, instructions to a class, and one youngster doesn't get it, or maybe two or three don't get it, then I can see, you know, we need to work more closely with those young people. If 95% of the class says to me, I need more advice, I need more help, I need more guidance, it may be that what advice I'm giving them is wrong. So at what point did the implementation board realise that the generation of 20,000 pages of advice might not be about the inability of the person in the classroom to understand what you were asking of them, but it was about the quality of the guidance and what was behind that guidance. Surely the fact that that amount of advice had been generated can't all be put down to inability of the staff to understand it. Surely there must have been a trigger point where you said, I mean, you made the point people were asking for advice. It was requests for advice that prompted more. At what point did those requests for advice perhaps trigger something in your head that it's maybe something about what you're doing or what the advice that's gone out rather than the person that's receiving it? I would have thought that would have been, to me, a symptom of a deeper problem. I don't know whether Fiona Robertson has a view on that.
When I can only repeat what I said earlier, which was about the advice from a number of agencies was in response to requests from the system, and indeed was welcomed.
And I'm asking you, at what point do you think, why do people keep asking for why do people keep asking for more advice? Is it something we're doing rather than something they're not understanding?
Yeah. I mean, Bill is chair of the implementation group might want to reflect further on that, but. You know, I think the curriculum framework itself, I mean, this is not a highly prescriptive, this is not a prescriptive curriculum. So as Terry has said, we're not expecting all teachers to work their way through every page of guidance. The guidance is a suite of materials that can be accessed at different times by different subject specialists. So I think that the issue of the volume can be a little misplaced in considering how that material
so
is accessed.
So your actual position is that the 20,000 pages is legitimate. That volume is either an inappropriate burden or it's a necessary response. It can't be both.
Mr. Maxwell, you want to come in and then...
Can I elaborate? I would argue much of it was appropriate response at that point in time when it was requested and served a useful purpose for a period of time and then has a natural time span, which, for example, in the very early days, we were modelling learner journeys before the new curriculum model existed, so there was some guidance about what new pathways through a senior phase curriculum that didn't at that point exist might look like. Clearly now these models can disappear as more practical examples from real life experience are experienced by schools across the country. But I would say that we do take feedback when we put out advice, and often we've set up working groups with other partners around the table involved to help develop the guidance. We certainly did that for the big exercise around the course materials for National 5, 4, Higher and Advanced Higher, to get feedback on were these hitting the mark. I won't pretend, you know, every piece of advice we've put out ever has absolutely hit the mark. And I would, if you wanted an example, I would say we have produced a couple of iterations where it's been clear that in the broad general education, teachers are needing more support to understand the standards of level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4. Well, we put out some advice a year or two back, which we have on the basis of feedback and intelligence and what's happening on the ground, now taken out and replaced with the benchmarks, which are currently being produced and about to come out, which we're again assured are going to hit the mark much better. So there is a degree of feedback and development that goes into this. But as you say, it's important we downsize and remove old stuff as we replace it with material that is clearly better meeting teachers' needs.
So just to clarify, the 20,000 pages were necessary.
Yeah. Large parts of it were,
and they served their purpose. And the decluttering, the ending of bureaucracy, is not actually about something being overwhelmed and bureaucratic. It's just simply that it's been time-barred. It's no longer necessary, because I think... With respect to the characterisation from the union from Larry Flanagan has been that this is what's happened.
Dr. Brown, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, I just wanted to respond to the question around if we were getting feedback, what we were doing in terms of trying to understand, not just providing the documentation, but actually trying to understand whether that documentation was being valued or being valuable, or whether there was something else we should do. I think one of the things, particularly around the nature of the assessment and the qualifications we did, was when we were getting feedback around teachers, maybe, as you point out, it's not necessarily what's in the documents, but it's actually what they need to know. That is one of the reasons why we added understanding standards events and webinars that actually took a different approach to engaging with teachers, and that was seen as a much more positive engagement and a much better way in which the teachers could get the message and could really understand the nature of the standard.
Okay, thank you. We've taken some amount of time on this. I've got another couple of people want to come in on this subject, but let's keep it brief and let's make sure that the responses are brief as well, please. Ross Thompson, then Fulton, then Tavish.
Thank you very much, convener. Again, my question is around about subject choice. Now, a number of authorities in my own region of the North East, following obviously Education Scotland and SQA guidance, took a narrow view of needing 160 hours in 1 year rather than over 2 years and therefore six subjects. So my question would be, if the belief truly is that the curriculum for excellence is a better curriculum, and therefore by its principles, should students therefore not be more likely to do eight subjects? And so is the management board comfortable with the guidance and the advice that came from Education Scotland and the SQA at that time?
The original guidance, which I have here, which was from the management board, a statement from the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board in 2011, obviously was from the management board itself, was fully agreed by the management board, and it highlights issues, including what they call issues for clarification around the timetable, the range of provision, the presentation for qualifications and the perceptions around potentially narrowing the curriculum around the number of subjects, and finally early presentation. Those were all issues, I understand, at the time, which were very live issues, and the management board were seeking to clarify. Now, Bill Maxwell restated the position around the number of subjects in his statement in May 2016, and he may wish to elaborate on that further. But the issue around subject choice, I think it's quite important to highlight, the issue around subject choice specifically was effectively a restatement of the previous statement by the management board back in 2011.
Yeah, and I think we've covered the issue of number of subjects in each year pretty well already, but fundamentally that was the position, that is the design principle. And bear in mind also that part of the design principle is a broader entitlement for all young people to achieve across the broad range of the broad general education curriculum by the end of third year.
If you're coming back, I'd make it short.
Yeah, well, I appreciate the guidance that was issued in the summer of last year. My understanding is that guidance said essentially that five subjects was unacceptable, but never really gave any indication around about six. And would you not agree that the restriction in subject choice is an unintended consequence of totally badly thought out guidelines?
No, the statement is built entirely on the principles that were, as Fiona's indicated, established early on in the process through the design phase of the delivery of the programme. It allows for a broader general education up to age 15, end of third year, and then a coherent three-year phase of senior phase, which provides breadth, and Terry's already illustrated how these new models can provide better breadth and depth towards coherent destinations post-school.
Have you come in later?
Very briefly, I mean, therefore, with that answer, would you not agree then if you're leaving an S4, you're leaving school, and you're leaving with less qualifications than you would have had before, the very young people that we're hoping to help as part of the government's agenda of narrowing the attainment gap are the ones that we will therefore be letting down? Is this not an attainment gap widening measure than actually a narrowing measure?
If I can answer that, then increasingly few young people are leaving education at the end of S4, and indeed in most schools they would be planning for young people to move on into further training, college and other destinations. Key to the model of curriculum for excellence is, as Larry's indicated earlier, taking stock of the broad general education at the end of S3, schools should be planning for onward destinations. Indeed, one of the key ambitions of Curriculum for Excellence was to create more coherent, if I can use vocational in inverted commas, routes for young people and do that better. And that's where I think the synergy with the developing young workforce agenda is proving increasingly powerful, as schools are looking at new ways of developing pathways that may not all be in school. They may leave after fourth year from school, but move on into apprenticeships, into college training, etc.
Okay, thank you very much. We've got a couple of the witnesses want to come back in, but what I'd like to do is I'd like to ask Tavish and Fulton to make their points and then come in at that stage. Can you make it brief, please, Tavish?
Well, I'll ask a question if it can be very quickly. Mr. Lanigan, you rightly talked about sitting five hires in fifth year. I think the point that Joanne Lambert was really driving at in the Sunday one I want to ask you is, but you're sitting five in your model out of six. You used to be able to sit five subjects out of eight choices. You've narrowed, for those kids who've got to sit five in one year, because that's what the university wants, and that's a point Joanne Lambert was pushing you all on. You've only, and I know this from personal experience, you're only sitting five out of six. Do you not accept that five out of eight gives pupils more choice as to what they may wish to do?
By definition, it does, but it's what you lose by creating that additional choice.
Not for that pupil who has to have five in one year.
No, I think if the planning is correct, Mr. Scott, From what we are saying, that if you plan correctly from S4 onwards, then you should also remember that previously choice was made at the end, at the start of S, at the end of S2. So there's less maturity there, there's less experience under this system. There's more chance that the youngster is going to get it right. And as far as the previous question was concerned about S4 leavers, I would argue, Mr. Thompson, that it's the quality of the qualifications that the S4 leavers, that small number of pupils who leave at the end of S4, the quality and the nature and the appropriateness of the qualification, particularly in relation to vocational qualifications, is what matters. And indeed, given that most S4 leavers are from the less able group, many of these were the youngsters who really struggled with 8 subjects and who were quite overwhelmed by the previous system.
So, on the subject of local responsibility, which I think we've obviously talked about a good bit, and I'm aware that COSLA aren't here, what really struck me during the evidence sessions was a kind of a blame culture, I think, that existed. Certainly that was my reading of it. So, for example, when we had COSLA or Education Scotland, there was an emphasis on, well, a lot of the curriculum's the local authority's responsibility. And similarly, when we had Stephanie Primrose, she was putting a lot back to, you know, yourselves. And I'm aware that COSLA's not here. So this might be a bit simplistic. I think my colleagues around the table have scrutinised quite well in terms of what, you know, how decisions were made and where we're at. But really what I want to know is, how are you going to take things forward? And that's a question more for Dr. Brown and Dr. Maxwell. How are you going to take things forward in terms of working with local authorities going forward to deal with some of the concerns that you've heard from the committee over the recent weeks and months, and basically get the curriculum right as it's intended to do for the young people that you serve? As I've said before at previous sessions, I think there's a lot of good work going across all the agencies represented and all the schools across the country. I don't think AMD would dispute that. I don't think AMD has. But how can you move this forward? And I'll just keep it to yourself. Thanks.
Yeah. Do you want to go first, then?
In terms of the qualifications, there's obviously been a decision ratified by the CFA Management Board that the units will be removed. And we are currently in the process of redesigning the assessments associated with the qualifications in order to take that forward. One of the things we absolutely need to do is make sure every single teacher in Scotland understands and knows about that. Our current mechanisms of communication are, as we've seen, not always reaching every teacher. And so what we are currently doing is trying to understand how we can best engage with teachers to make sure that they are fully aware of what's going on. The time frame that we have to do this in means that the level of consultation that occurred during the course of the initial construction of the qualifications is not going to be possible as we're going forward with the changes that we're making now. One of the things we've been talking to the professional associations about is how we can engage with them in a more proactive way. We've done that in the past. In fact, both the SSTA, NASUWT and DIS have very helpfully communicated to their members a lot of the changes that we have been making. And one of the things we're doing is having subsequent conversations in the next couple of weeks to make sure that we try and maximise the amount of information that we can get out through as many channels as possible to make sure that teachers are aware of the changes so that it does have the impact that is intended, which is to reduce the amount of work associated with unit assessments that is as a result of the unit assessments themselves.
Okay, and specifically asked about links with local authorities, and I can reassure you, I mean, partly Terry's already indicated the ADES work closely with us, so we work with a curriculum network that runs across ADES, certainly. But equally, we have an area lead officer for each of the 32 local authorities, one of our staff who links with them regularly, who explores with them how they're implementing various national initiatives, but Curriculum for Excellence is clearly a key one amongst those. And increasingly, we're also seeing more collaboration, which is a healthy thing, I think, across local authorities. So there's a Tayside group now, for example. You may have heard of the Northern Alliance, which is bringing together discussions across Highlands and Islands territory. So we're working closely with them to exchange, both to draw the best practice out from what's happening locally in certain local authorities and make that known more widely across the country, but also to support, but also challenge what's happening in their schools. And in certain circumstances, of course, we inspect schools in each local authority too, so we get some first-hand evidence of what's happening locally. And where there are particular issues arising, we will support a local authority in addressing those. And that's happened in a few specific instances.
I'm happy to leave it that. Can be a further question on speech and language, but I'm happy to bring that in a wee bit later if there's a...
Okay, thank you, Fulton. Mr. Flanagan and Mr. Lanigan wanted to come in earlier on. You find out... Can you make it brief, please?
Because it was back to the question around a number of subjects. And one of the difficulties we've had in Scottish education is moving towards the idea of it's the qualification you leave with which is important, rather than the sequence of qualifications that you build up through a stepladder approach, which was the old system under standard aid and higher still. And there is an issue around the number of subjects studied in the senior phase, but it's not really about the assessment, the qualification routes, because part of that breadth was supposed to be about giving young people space to actually do a vocational course along with their Five Fires, or to do Duke of Edinburgh, or to do community volunteering. And when you're doing six subjects in S4 and six in S5, you're squeezing out all that additional ambition around wider achievement, which was a big part of the thinking. And the key to it is what happens in S3. Because in S3, as Terry alluded to there, actually young people study more subjects for a year longer than they used to under the old system. And that's meant to give them more choice around their senior phase pathway. And whether a young person's leaving school in S4, S5 or S6, their S3 profile is the responsibility of the school to map out a three-year journey to the age of 18 for all young people, whether that's directly into work or whether it's moving through college or going on directly to a university. That bit of it isn't happening at the moment because of the way we've arrived at where we are. And I think the qualification review group, which has been chaired by the DFM, I know that that has on its agenda the interface between S3 and the senior phase. And if we get S3 right, a number of the challenges around the senior phase will start to make more sense. So the DFM has to complete that work. And then I think that if we get big decisions around that, and the DFM is using his authority as Cabinet Secretary to message that to the system, then I think we will actually be in a much stronger place to achieve the original ambitions.
OK, thank you very much. Colin, we're coming back to governance. It's your shot, mate. We're coming back to CFE governance. You've got questions around about that, haven't you?
I do, actually. I've got, actually, a couple of questions here for Larry Flanagan and Bill Maxwell. And I'm looking at the EIS submission. And in it, EIS is obviously not very complimentary about the CFE Management Board. In fact, in paragraph 2, the suggestion is that the CFE board's reached the end of its natural lifespan and that it should be replaced. And I'd be interested to know, firstly, what would it be replaced with?
I thought we were very fair in our view on the CFE management board. I'm absolutely clear. The management board, as I think I indicated earlier, has been a model for collaborative practice, particularly around the development phase. The challenges have arisen around implementation, and a lot of those implementation issues are at school and local authority level. There was a reference made to COSLA not here today. COSLA haven't taken up a seat in the management board ever. They used to send a delegate from IDES. No, they used to send two IDES people.
COSLA have been on the board for a number of years. And
but yeah, they've been on the board from the beginning, in theory, right? But they never sent him. They always sent two IDES people. And that is a real issue.
It's not true.
Okay, I'll stand corrected then. In relation to what replaces it, I think there's an open discussion around that. I don't think the management board should be disbanded at this stage until we have cracked the S3 and the qualifications. But thereafter, there does come a point where you cannot be implementing a programme 15 years after its inception. We need to move forward as a system. And I'm much more interested in the processes around pedagogy and how we support teacher development. That's the big agenda, I think, once we get beyond implementation.
Just to come back to the submission that was made, it says here that EIS for the past period believes that the CFE board has reached the end of its natural life. You must have a plan as to what, how you would like to see it reconstructed.
We'd like to see it replaced with a strategic board that is focused more upon pedagogy and curriculum development rather than looking at the implementation of a specific programme. Because my view very strongly is that the way we're going to achieve improvements in our school is by moving away from an obsession around qualifications and actually looking at pedagogy and teaching practice. So it's around professional development, and that's an agenda that we have already started discussing with Scottish Government in terms of the International Summit on the Teaching Profession. There have been a number of initial experiments around supporting pedagogical improvement. There is already a body around initial teacher education. So I think something along those lines, and that's what was hinted at in the OECD report, would be much more effective. The issue around the CFE board and a review of it is something we raised, I think, around 2 years ago with Angela Constance. Clearly, given the issues around the qualifications, that work has to be completed. But once that work is completed, then I do think, you know, that we've moved beyond implementation. We need to look more broadly at how we support Scottish education.
Just to pick up a second question here, I'm hoping Bill Maxwell will come in and maybe answer the two together. In paragraph 13 of your submission, you say that the CFE Management Board only ever had power to recommend courses of action to the appropriate Education Minister. And if I look at the submission from the Scottish Government and Education Scotland, there, paragraphs 4 and 5, it seems to imply that the Management Board actually had quite a bit more power. Mm. And I'm just wondering how that squares.
Well, my view is that in the development phase, where we were looking at curriculum and looking at what I would call professional issues around education, Scottish Government were very keen to take fairly strong advice from the Management Board. I think we moved into a phase where a lot of the implementation issues became highly politicised, not least over the last couple of years, where there's been a very strong focus on education. And we have made a lot of direct approaches to Scottish Government because that's where we saw the decision-making locus. So,
say, you're saying here that the Management Board only ever had the power to recommend. That's a lot different from strong advice or whatever. How does that equate to how the Scottish Government and Education Scotland see it and how EIS are seeing it?
Well, I think every minister would say that they retain the right to accept or reject the advice from the Management Board, whether it's a strong recommendation or, you know, lukewarm one. The buck stops with the Cabinet Secretary. They have the decision-making power.
Surely it's got more power than just making a recommendation to the Minister. I mean, it must have, according to the Scottish Government, it's got a lot more power than that.
It doesn't in any formal sense. It's entirely dependent on how the Minister accepts the recommendations.
It's been answered, Colin. Okay.
Maybe Bill Maxwell might have a comment.
Very clearly at the very start of the session by Fiona, but fundamentally what the Management Board has is authority rather than power, if you put it in that sense, because clearly ultimately, as Larry says, the Cabinet Secretary has the ultimate power on decision-making and in major aspects of policy, but it has a lot of authority because of the makeup and the consensual, the membership covering such a broad church in what is fundamentally a system where authority lies at multiple levels. So it makes authoritative recommendations that Cabinet Secretary clearly considers carefully when it comes to that.
And what about the EIS's proposal that it's come to the end of its lifespan?
Clearly, major programmes of reform go through periods. There, as was described earlier, there's a development design phase, there's an implementation phase, and I think as the OECD report also signalled very strongly, we're moving really into a benefits realisation phase now, and I think it will. There's work to be finished around the qualifications, again, as Larry says, but I think the time is coming to take a fresh look at how this guiding alliance, because that has been the power of what's happened, has been the strong efforts made to work with all stakeholders, developing consensus wherever possible, how that's maintained beyond may require different mechanisms going forward, but not quite yet.
So you would agree that you're coming to a point where a review might be beneficial?
It's worthy of review, and of course the government is reviewing governance of education more generally at the moment.
Buzz?
Thank you, Convener. Can I go back to this issue about subject choice, because Bill Maxwell and Janet Brown both very helpfully, I mean, say, in their own evidence to the committee, made it very clear that conversations still have to be had, I think is the phrase that you both used respectively in the transcript. And I think conversations do still have to be had about subject choice. And I'd be interested in a parental input on this as well, because I think it's not just about the number of subjects that are available within, you're right, Larry Flanagan, it's over a period from S3 right up to S6 on the learner journey. We have to see it in that context. But the other crucial context, and Mr. Flanagan mentioned the issue about universities, every university in the land just now is making the point that subject choice is absolutely crucial, not just in terms of the number, but in the groupings that they can do, because although we've got more Scottish domiciled students going on to university places, we have actually got more who are not getting places because that demand is rising much faster than the availability of the places. So the groupings of the subjects that you can do at different year groups is absolutely crucial. And I know for a fact that you have had letters about that. We've all had letters as from constituents who are making the point that their sons and daughters can't always do the subjects that they want to be able to get into the relevant college or university course. Is this a conversation that we need to review, and very quickly?
If I can comment on that, it's certainly something we need to keep under review and look at how that's provided. Sometimes it's provided actually by schools collaborating together or schools working with local colleges for more minority interest subjects, because young people will have different patterns sometimes that are difficult to meet in a small school or in a school that hasn't typically provided that subject in the past. It's always been an issue. It would have been an issue in the previous curriculum. It's an issue going forward in the current curriculum, but one that needs to be kept constantly under. It's partly been why it's been helpful to have University of Scotland on the management board again as part of this. They did produce a paper called Beyond the Senior Phase on the back of initial discussions around how universities were going to adapt to the new patterns of qualifications that might appear. So absolutely. And the whole work going on around improving the careers advice and guidance service right back into primary and broad general education plays into this agenda too, because it's important young people understand the pathways that they are
building. But with respect, it's not just about universities adapting, which, you know, I think they're more flexible than they used to be, but it's also about schools adapting. Yeah. And to take up Mr. Flanagan's point, it's about introducing the flexibility, which I agree it's there in theory, but it by no means is it there in practice in too many schools. That's the issue that we're facing. And that is part of the delivery of the curriculum for excellence. I know my colleague Joanne Lamont wants to talk about the S4 situation where the lack of the external assessment there. There are crucial issues about whether in practice we're actually delivering what youngsters are able to pick up for the best possible opportunities that they have beyond the school. Is that fair?
In my experience, schools are better than they have ever been at giving that level of flexibility. And I suppose if I reflect on my own experience as director over the last 5 years in my local authority, we have extended, for instance, the use of consortium arrangements among schools. We have extended the use of college places, not just for youngsters to go to college during the school day, but also college lecturers coming into school to deliver a range of courses. And I can say with absolute confidence that the youngsters that are going through, certainly the schools in my area today, have got a far greater degree of flexibility and choice than they had 5 or 10 years ago.
Just finish on the comment that that's good to hear, but we're just getting a lot of letters from constituents whose sons and daughters feel otherwise.
However, that it is impossible to deliver a system that would allow absolutely every possible choice because of the way that schools are run, and because at times if you only have one or two pupils wanting to do a particular subject, you simply can't run with it. And I understand parents' frustrations with that, but at times schools simply can't deliver if there's not a sufficient number of youngsters that choose the subject.
That's fine.
Right, thank you. Gillian and Tavish had small, short supplementaries.
Yeah. largely my main question has already been answered a lot around workload, so I'm not so fussed if there's time issues there. Larry Flanagan said something which absolutely just piqued my interest very much about focusing on pedagogy more than qualifications and assessment and examination-led curriculum. And that very much, I agree with that. I think it's long overdue, and I think we need to do that. However, we exist in a culture that is obsessed with assessment and examination. We have intense political scrutiny. We have intense media. You'll just have to look at the PISA results that came out to see the hoo-ha around that in terms of them. Are we looking to other countries for inspiration that are high achieving in education but have got a completely different model? And I maybe want to bring in Joanna Murphy on this, because obviously reaching out to parents is going to be really, really important if we are to do a complete overhaul in terms of the educational culture. So I'd like to hear a little bit more about that really, and how you see the challenges of that going forward.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important to remember that Curriculum for Excellence was essentially a pedagogical innovation. And we've become over-obsessed with processes around it. Even in the SPICE document that you have, it talks about CFE being introduced in secondary schools and creates a timeline which aims towards the first qualifications. But in actual fact, CFE was introduced to secondary schools at the same time as primary schools, because the pedagogical changes were communicated around, to all elements. And that's part of the difficulty, that everything gets measured against the qualifications framework. And no one is saying that assessment is not important. Assessment is absolutely part and parcel of the teaching process. I think if you look at some of the high-performing countries in PISA, for example, like Finland, actually, you'll see very strong echoes of what some of the things that they are doing in Curriculum for Excellence, particularly around the focus on teacher quality and professional development. I think the difficulty is that we've been bogged down in procedures around qualifications to the detriment of that much more productive work stream. And I think if we can get past this qualifications issue and get them bedded in, that then opens the door around looking at pedagogy as the main driver for the improvements. And that's not about governance, that's about processes and attitudes from school leaders and from education leaders across the country. Interestingly, because Bill's sitting there, Finland don't have an inspectorate and they seem to do fine. And they also have exit qualifications. Young people sit exams in Finland when they are leaving school. So the rest of the time is geared towards building. So I think there are definitely lessons we can learn there.
The committee is not suggesting for a second that somebody's made unemployed.
Good.
Body, we met last year, very helpful.
Already looking for a job. Sorry, Gillian, are you?
I think Mr. Lanagan wanted to come in.
Yes, just to say, I mean, I think it's worth reminding ourselves that the OECD report indicated that all of the building blocks are there within Scottish education to be a world-leading system. And in fact, Pasi Salberg from Finland addressed the ADES annual conference in November and made it very clear that he thought that Scotland was exactly in the right place to be a world leader. The same was said by Andy Hargreaves. These are two of the international advisors to to the Scottish Government at the moment, and they were exceptionally complimentary about where we're going. Now, they made it clear that we haven't got everything in place yet, and the recommendations in the OECD report, they're all being taken forward by the various bodies to try to address where we're perhaps not delivering, but they are very clear that all of the leading systems are doing exactly what Scotland has done over recent years.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Tavish and then Ross Thompson.
Very quickly, Convener, and I apologise, Larry Flanagan, about obsession about process, but can I ask, following Colin Beattie's points about governance, I wonder if I could ask Fiona Robson, did the Management Board, as a matter of course, after every meeting, make a series of recommendations to the Cabinet Secretary of the day?
The process around the Management Board, ministers are made aware in the normal course of events of discussions at the Management Board. Depending on the nature of the discussion at the Management Board would depend on the nature of the advice that was provided to ministers. But as already been highlighted during the course of the discussion, there have been a number of very clear ministerial decisions as a result of advice from the Management Board.
So it would be possible to furnish the committee with some of that, which is now clearly in the past, but some illustrations of where the Management Board made a clear recommendation and then presumably sent a minute to the Cabinet Secretary saying, Minister, Cabinet Secretary, we need you to do X, or we recommend you do X.
I think the timeline that's been provided by Spice highlights a number of those key decisions.
I'm
that
I'm asking you if you'd furnish our committee with evidence that illustrates the point you've just very fairly made to the committee.
I can look at what can be provided to the committee separately.
Thank you very much. Ross.
Thank you very much, Convener. As a supplementary following on the line of questioning from Liz Smith, if you had a choice of eight subjects and you decided that you wanted to go to university, let's say to study science, just as an example, so you choose the five subjects that you need for that particular course, and because you've got eight, you then have that flexibility to change, so for whatever reason, you decide by S5 that going in and studying science is not for you, you actually have that flexibility to make some change. Under six subjects, does that not make it impossible for you to change route if that's something that you wish to do?
Well, I mean, I think the issue is when you're making those choices. I mean, if you look at an S3 profile, you're delaying the choice for a further year, so young people and their parents will have a better basis for making that decision because, one, they're older, but also they'll have more experience with the subjects. If you're making subject choices in S2, you tend to be doing it around January of second year. So you've been in secondary schools for a year and a half, and you then do your eight subjects, and then that would normally, after 2 years, go down to five. If you have a bypass system in place and you have eight choices across 2 years, you've actually got the best of both worlds because you can actually create that additional flexibility around it. There's not a huge number of young people looking to do three sciences. That's not your highest demand in relation to timetabling. And it does come back to the point I think Terry was hinting at in relation to Liz's question. Timetable options are resource-led. You need to have the teachers and you need to have the demand. The days when schools could run classes for five, six, seven pupils are long gone. So any timetabler will basically say, if you haven't got at least 10 picking it as an option, it's not even getting looked at. And this is to do with budget pressure. Schools have had to cut their cloth. So schools that maybe had a bit of flexibility in the past around running an additional science course or additional languages course to meet a relatively small demand, that option quite often is off the table now, and that's, for a school timetabler or a head teacher looking at the options, that's a very real pressure that has to be factored in.
Thank you. Right. Okay, thank you very much. Richard?
Yeah, thank you. I think in the interest of brevity, I'll just address my question to maybe Terry Lanigan, unless anyone over this side of the table wants to come in. In terms of delivering the curriculum around Scotland, some local authorities at the moment are struggling to attract applications from new teachers. So there's a shortage of teachers. And that, I know, in some areas could potentially jeopardise the delivery of the curriculum from August 2017 onwards. because the teachers are not there. They have to review what can be delivered. It's been put to me by some people in the education sector that if Education Scotland split between the scrutiny role and the development role, and the development role was devolved to either regions of local authorities or whatever, that would help in a more local basis address some of these challenges. I just want to know if Terry Lanigan has had that feedback from his directors of education, and if any others want to come in from this side of the table over here.
I think there are arguments for and against the splitting of the two functions of Education Scotland. I can't think that it would help in terms of the recruitment of teachers. I mean, we are in a difficult position at the moment, that we are, and certain parts of the country, North East in particular, is really struggling to fill posts. And that is a challenge for the system, and that's about a number of issues, workforce management issues, which have to be dealt with at a national level. I think there are also issues to do with dropout rates in some of the courses, both at the university, the general university courses, but also the teacher education university courses, which have to be looked at. I can't see the relevance of the role of Education Scotland to the attraction of teachers.
You're focusing on the attraction of teachers. I'm saying as a result of a lack of teachers, there may have to be changes made to curriculum locally. And
well, that happens at present, that sometimes as a result of the difficulty in recruiting, for instance, there's an issue at the moment with computing science teachers, and curriculum has to be adapted locally just now. But I wouldn't see the division of Education Scotland and the devolving of that to a local level helping with recruitment.
Okay, right. Thank you very much. Joanne?
Thank you very much. I wanted to ask just really about this. We did in previous Education Committee sessions try to establish, it's a process thing for me, and this is this question of when National 4 became something that was internally assessed, because we note in the beginning we were told that you know there'd been expectation that basically there were external exams at all levels where they're currently used for certification, and they talked about the inclusive nature of the standard grade, and by the following year there's decision to make National 4 simply to be assessed by internally. Now I have to say that the first time in all of these sessions we've had a coherent explanation of what some of the thinking around that might be, and I think Larry Flanagan has explained very helpfully the idea of qualification shifting further up the school year, because more young people stay on. Certainly when I was still teaching, very few kids and stayed on for a sixth year, and they certainly didn't work as intensively as my own children did by the time they got to sixth year. But I'm interested in the processes, because we weren't able to establish when that decision was made and who made it. And I wonder whether Education Scotland can, or SQA can, clarify when that decision was made.
There was a group, as Fiona highlighted at the beginning, at different times during the course of the development process, different groups were formed by the CFE Management Board. And there was a qualifications governance group that was formed to specifically look at agreeing the process for signing off the design principles of the new qualifications and to agree the design principles themselves. The membership of that group was very broad and wide-ranging. It had representation from the professional associations, from the then LTS, a part of Education Scotland, from the college sector, from ADES, from School Leaders Scotland, and from SQA. It was that group that discussed and worked through the design principles and agreed that National 4, given the nature of National 4 being potentially the exit qualification for those candidates who might be going on to college courses, that internal assessment was the most appropriate assessment to be put in place for National 4. The National 4 internal assessment would, however, be quality assured by SQA to ensure that there was a national standard applied. And that is what was recommended to the CFE Management Board, which then accepted that and that then passed that up to ministers to approve.
Explain how useful it is to have a qualification that's neither externally examined and is only pass or fail. in terms of giving more information about a young person. I'm troubled, and I'd be interested to know what the EIS view on this was, and I'm happy to be corrected on it, but my own experience was that where there was non-certificate courses, no funding followed that within schools, even where there should have been. Because it wasn't externally assessed, the budgets within schools actually became constrained, and young people didn't have the same kind of quality of course that standard grade brought in. And in the early days in this, it's clear that it regards that the initial proposal was that there would be external qualification examination for anything that had been certificated in that way. And I don't see that. It feels like an opaqueness around that decision to move from that, yes, it should be externally examined, to not only should it be internally assessed, but it should be a pass or fail. So I wonder what consideration was given in that regard.
I think there's two issues. The National Four is certificated. There are a lot of qualifications that many awarding bodies, but
externally assessed. That's what it says. The proposal for the replacement to standard grade at this stage included an external exam, quote, at all levels where they are currently used for certification.
And that was the original point. There was then a group set up which had a very broad church within it in terms of the membership that actively discussed the value of internal versus external assessment, but the importance of assuring standards through quality assurance. And there was a very detailed conversation. I'm sure Larry will come in on this. The point I was trying to make was that there are internally assessed, externally quality assured qualifications delivered across all jurisdictions. All of the Scottish qualifications in the vocational space have internally assessed units that are highly valued by both parents, both students, and within employers. The National Four was seen as fitting into that space.
I don't know. Why was it only a pass-fail?
The pass-fail, I think, is a different discussion. That was also one of the recommendations that came out of the Qualifications Governance Group.
Yeah. Again, if you look at S3, the ambition around the broad general education was that level 3 in CFE was the minimum entitlement of young people. So that's basic literacy and numeracy. The aspiration of S1 to S3 was that most young people would get to CFE level 4, which is the top end of the experiences and outcomes, which equates to a standard grade 4 pass. So the qualifications were based on the idea that most young people at the end of S3, when they're doing their S3 profile, would hopefully be achieving level 4 across most areas. And therefore, their natural targets in terms of qualifications, and this is the qualifications group was actually looking at the idea of two-year and exit qualifications, would be either National 5 or higher. And there was a lot of discussion around whether or not there should be an exam. In fact, the initial discussion was National 5 wasn't going to have an external exam. And Fiona Hislop ruled that out and said that that would be a step too far, and probably, given the experience around National 4, that would probably have been a good judgment. But the discussion in that group was around moving to akin to the Finnish system, the idea of exit qualifications. The College of Scotland made a very, very strong argument around not having external examination for National 4, because National 4 was a progression into college courses. And within the college courses, their default position was that all their units, unless they were doing SQA-related, but their units around most of their courses were internally assessed and validated by colleges. So there was a very strong argument put that for the group of pupils, it was anticipated that National 4 would be their exit qualification from school. That was a more appropriate pathway. Bearing in mind that, again, the anticipation was that a good number of these pupils would actually be doing a mixture of school and college-based placements. So that part of the CFE programme was that some young people might be doing their fourth year in colleges rather than in schools. Now, that hasn't been realised. In practice, what has happened, because N4 and N5 came in together, replacing general and credit standard grade, there's been a huge over-presentation around N4, mainly because schools aren't confident about CFE levels 3 and 4 in S3, because they've not been doing them, because they've made the subject choice in S2.
the discussion within the qualification review group is that N4 has not worked in the way that it's been used. We have certainly raised that we think there needs to be, to give it credibility and address some of the concerns around it, there now needs to be some level of external assessment validation. And that's part of the discussion that's now taking place, whether that can be done through an exam or whether it can be done through an externally mapped added value unit. That discussion hasn't taken place, but the issue around it and the recognition that for a number of young people who are doing N4s, and N4 is their top level, the qualification doesn't carry the same status that we hoped it would, and isn't seen in the way it was intended. So that there are issues to be addressed around that.
It's really helpful because you described the Cabinet Secretary with N5 being a step too far, but for this particular group, they have neither got effective rigour around the third-year profile, nor have they necessarily got access to college in fourth year. And because some of them will go to college, we're not allowing an external examination for some young people who were able to... You could show to the world, I attended school, I was a good attender, I'd achieved certain things across the stage, which did stand a grade, maybe it's well out of date, but it did provide that for a particular group of young people. Can I just ask, on the back of that, and if the convener will permit me, that there's clearly a lot of issues here around Curriculum for Excellence, things that need to be revisited, precisely for the reasons you described. We've been told in our budget consideration that Curriculum for Excellence has now reached a level of maturity that allows Education Scotland and SQA's budget to be cut, and I think SQA by something like half. Is it the view of the unions and indeed of Education Scotland and SQA that we have reached that maturity that can justify that decision?
Well, I think in relation to the changes that have been agreed around N5 and higher and advanced higher, there's clearly a work stream still live there. We press very strongly for SQA to introduce the changes, the removal of the units for higher and that five both next year. And SQA said that they couldn't achieve that. And in my view, that's largely resource driven because they don't have the same number of staff and they can't afford the same number of secondees out of schools. And also there's a pressure on schools not letting people out anyway. So, there's been an issue there. I think around N4, well, it depends to some extent what a decision is, but clearly there's liable to be a work stream there also, which I think has to be funded because at the moment, well, I don't know, I'm not on the SQA board, but at the moment I'm assuming that there isn't a funding stream around that because SQA have a relatively small core staff. A lot of this development work is done by getting teachers out of school, who are subject experts. So, I wouldn't necessarily be calling for, MD's budget to be cut because it might come back to bite me. But, I think there has to be a funding stream there around ensuring that this work is completed. I think a lot of the other stuff around senior phase and articulation, a lot of that is around process. So that isn't necessarily got a huge cost attached to it. But, it's about alignment of, local authority and school decision-making around around process. So, in that sense, I think the big spending commitments around some of these areas is limited.
Curriculum for Excellence is mature?
Like a cheese. The tackling bureaucracy report was an indicator that things hadn't gone right in implementation across 3 to 15, because you wouldn't have to set up a working group to tackle bureaucracy if that bureaucracy hadn't been created. The Tackling Bureaucracy Report, which everyone around this table was involved in, came forward with really good recommendations. And then a year later had to issue a second report because they hadn't been implemented. And some of these are still... Now, these are operational issues around school reporting formats, around... online tracking systems. So there is still an agenda to be addressed there. But I think in terms of the ambitions and the curriculum elements, the guidance around decluttering has been really useful. The focus on literacy and numeracy has been really useful. I'm not convinced we need any more benchmarks, but that's another discussion. But I think we are at a stage where we should be looking towards realising the benefits of these changes. because all the groundwork is there. You know, and I think Terry alluded to the OECD report. The building blocks are all there. We now need to make sure that they gel together.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Can I just ask then, I mean, given that all the bodies who would be involved in the operational matters in the main are on the board, how did you come up with a report and then we couldn't implement it? It kind of takes us back to the discussion we had at the very beginning.
Yeah, but the CFE Management Board does not run 32 local authorities. And I can cite some very good practice from individual local authorities who have done a lot of work around modelling senior phase architecture and around curriculum. And there are others, and it's maybe back to the point that, Phil McGregor made around, or somebody asked a question around the support that might be come from Disaggregating Education Scotland. Local authorities across the country have seen, because of austerity pressures, their QIO networks been absolutely diminished, disappeared in some areas. So a lot of the pedagogical support that used to come at a local authority level has been subject to the cuts process, particularly where teacher numbers were being protected and that was part of the education budget that could be hit. And there is a gap there, I think. And I think there is genuine benefit looking at disaggregating some of the functions of Education Scotland into regional networks that are closer to the ground in terms of local authorities,
so
and give them something extra.
Why would you come up with a report where you know it can't be achieved? Mr. Lanigan, yourself particularly, again, I mean, Mr. Lanigan says he doesn't represent local authorities, but he is, but he's here representing the Director of Education, who are in every local authority, so clearly you have got some kind of overarching local authority role in terms of education. So why would you come up with a report and then knowing at the time, because of financial pressures or whatever, that it wasn't going to be achievable?
Well, firstly, I don't think that was what happened. I mean, the report was compiled, and indeed, many of the recommendations of that report were carried through at local authority level. And in the last school session, Education Scotland conducted a review of tackling bureaucracy across the 32 local authorities, and the majority of local authorities came out with a very positive report that through the LNCT particularly, but other devices, that they had worked hard and had succeeded in reducing bureaucracy. So it's not true to say that none of the recommendations were carried through, and I'm sure the EIS would acknowledge that. And indeed, Larry has said that there are some very good examples at local level.
Okay, right, thank you. I'd like to move on to Ross Green.
Thanks, Convener. I appreciate that there's a wide range of stakeholders involved in the management board, and teacher and parent input certainly seems to be there, but the gap that occurs to me is in direct learner input. So I'd like to pose the question to Fiona Robertson. What expectation is there at the management board of learner involvement in the decisions made or the recommendations made to ministers?
I think that's an important point. The breadth of membership of the management board and the fact that the teaching profession and indeed the leadership in education is represented, I think doesn't prevent the learner voice coming through. We try where possible to have meetings within schools, and as part of the discussion we've extended the meetings so that there are discussions with learners and with teachers within that context as well. Both the SQA and Education Scotland also have their own mechanisms for ensuring that there's a learner voice through that process. And some of the wider work that the government takes forward involves Children's Parliament, Young Scot, etc. So there's a broad range. So while the learner voice is not formally part of, young people are not formally part of the governance, if you like, of CFE in terms of formal representation on the board, I think there are a number of mechanisms that we've sought to use to ensure that that voice is heard. There was some work done with Children in Scotland, around this, and some really good work. And of course, through the National Parent Forum as well, I think the learner as well as the parent voice, that the learner voice comes through really quite strongly there too.
I do appreciate that, and I know certainly from experience that the teachers' unions are often very effective indeed in representing learners as well. But there's a difference between someone else advocating on the learner's behalf and actually indeed, having learners as part of the process. Yeah. I know from previous evidence sessions, Janet Brown has laid out SQA's consultation with learners, particularly around, I think, National 4 was yes, the example given. Yeah. But I'm wondering, in terms of the membership of the management board, mm-hmm, I mean, would you be able to explain how the membership is comprised and who ultimately makes that decision?
Well, the membership is, the membership is conveyed through the through ministers. So ministers have determined the membership of the management board over time, and indeed invitations to serve on the management board are expressed on behalf of ministers. So, and the composition of the management board, as it currently stands, has largely been in place since 2009, with some additional representation, I think, as I mentioned at the start of the meeting, to reflect the importance of the developing young workforce agenda on the senior phase.
I think that there is certainly, I think, the potential for a place for learners. I know the local authorities that have learners on their education committees, yeah, have certainly seen a significant improvement there. On a broader point, I was wondering if you'd be able to let us know, has there been any independent evaluations of the workings of the management board?
I think the OECD review met with the management board, also received material as part of its work from management board members and others. So I think some of the issues around the management board were taken forward as part of that report, and of course the governance review, the education governance review, which is just closed, will also considers issues pertaining to the management board and broader issues as well. So I think the OECD review is important in expressing that statement and the statement that I made at the start of the meeting around the centrality of the management board around the development of curriculum for excellence, but also that piece around that Larry in particular has expressed around potentially a shift going forward.
That does sound like essentially no, but other reviews have touched on it.
I think that's a fair reflection. Yeah,
and just turning to Mr. Searson and Ms. Murphy, Larry Flanagan had laid out a potential successor body to the management board. I was wondering if you had any thoughts on what its future is or the future of an alternative body.
In terms of the SSTA, we haven't been a party to the management board for a whole of the period. We were removed at one stage, so we only got back into the body back in September 2015. So that's why I reserve some of the comments on some of the detail on those. But as far as we're concerned, there is a need for a strategic body to look at education policy, not necessarily CFE, management board, but there needs to be a body that brings all the stakeholders together and looks at all those issues. My concern is that it is a body that makes recommendations to the minister. It doesn't make the big decisions. And one of the things that we are concerned about, as far as secondary teachers are concerned, is that we're one voice in a number of voices there. And it doesn't really give the prominence of the profession in some of the decision-making. Because if you take, for example, the issues of workload and the changes to the national qualifications, the unions pursued those matters outside of the CFE Management Board to make those changes. And I feel that's one of the things that we have raised. I mean, even the National Qualifications Working Group, which was established in January 2016, we welcome that. And we hope that changes will be made. But there's only three teacher unions on that panel. And we were the voice in the wilderness asking for some immediate change. And I think that's one of the things you would say in terms of the future. We need to make sure that we've got the people that are doing the job part of the decision making, and I feel that's missing here as regards the implementation group. There's no teacher unions at all involved in that group, and they're the ones that are doing the job, and I feel that this is where some of the messages need to come back. So it really is about having a voice for the teacher, the profession in the group, but it is also important to have the people around the table that are doing the work, and sometimes the groups are very big, and when any sort of working group is very difficult to manage when you've got a large range of people, because you can't really get down to the nitty-gritties. So in terms of the future, I think there is a need for a strategic board. The CFE element of it, I do think, isn't finished yet because the national qualifications need to be resolved, and they will be resolved. But I think there's also a major shift that needs to come into that, is that the teacher profession needs to be trusted to make the decisions, and that would reduce some of the workload. And unfortunately, that's one of the problems that we've got to overcome. Added to the other issue is we're trying to do all this when we've got a recruitment crisis. And I feel that that's something that's been underestimated. Some of the things that teachers are having to do where they're splitting classes to make sure the youngsters get a bit of coverage for their qualifications, I think those are the elements that are missing from the real discussion, is actually what is going on inside the schools at the moment. So I hope that gives a little bit of a steer where we're coming from.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Forgive me if I don't articulate this quite in the same way as all my colleagues here. I think I should say at this point that I am a parent. I'm not an educational specialist. I'm here representing other parents who, again, bring their children in good faith to schools and trust the good work of the classroom teachers day in, day out. As a volunteer, and as parents, again, also volunteers, the whole process, I think it's also, the whole process often passes us by. I think it's telling that at 12:05, we finally get round to talking to parents. We were kind of mentioned in passing a couple of times, but again, it goes on to pressing and obviously important matters. This is not a battle between parents and everyone else, but I think that parents have a lot to give to this. They have been very well represented at the management board. We have been at the management board since almost it started. But in very many other parts of the education system, we get brought in just at the end, just to rubber stamp, or we're told what's happening, and or even worse, we're not really told what's happening. You're left to just kind of, I hate to say, beat it out of your children, but almost, you almost, almost, you know, cajole it out of your, you know, we shouldn't, they're the conduit to many of the decisions, because they are obviously, and naturally, they're in school. They're the ones that are sitting the exams. They're the ones that are, you know, there's not been a lot of talk of primary. They're the ones in primary one going in and learning to read and write through the system, and how Curriculum for Excellence has really, really changed the way that the young people at that age go in and experience the world around them and the school system. My own experience with my own daughters is that one has went through the system entirely in the old system, and one, the middle one's done a bit of both, and one at the end has gone through the whole new Curriculum for Excellence experience. And so I can see it from all of the point of views. I don't want to bring, obviously, it's not fair to highlight them in this, but I can see the process, I can see the differences that have been made, particularly in primary school, and having had a daughter in the first cohort to go through S4, 5 and 6, I could see as a parent how difficult it was for the young people, how the schools struggled to cope for the young people and the teachers, but also how the parents were very often left behind and didn't really get included. Because again, they're an add-on. It's time, it's money, and it's trying to get the parents involved in a time that suits the schools and the actual parents that have to go along.
Okay, sorry, Ross, when you go, you finished. Thank you very much, Sam. Can I just say that you could have participated at any time during the day? We weren't banning you from talking until the end, I can assure you. It's nice to see you again. Okay, thank you very much for that lengthy session. It was very useful for the committee, and I now close the public session. Thank you.